We're so excited and happy to have you on. This is actually our very first live hybrid simulcast around the country right now. So we are broadcasting to WFG agents around the country for a premium financing conference that we are doing today. So you are the first folks to see this live as well. So happy and excited to kind of be here for that. So at Pacific Life, we have a number of different vendors we can work with, as you have a number of different insurance companies you can choose to place your business with as well. Today, we have a guy named Darren Sugiyama with us today. And we've worked with Darren for a while at Pacific Life as a company. In fact, at one time, Darren was responsible for at least, 20%, probably of the 25% of the app flow just within the Orange County territory of Pacific Life alone. He has built an original business from scratch, which is amazing, too. He's been in the business for a long number of years. And in fact, he actually started out really more of a teaching profession, more than anything else, before he actually got into the life insurance side. I think he'll tell you a little bit about maybe his first experience in the life insurance, which is quite a story, by the way. But we've had fantastic success working with him. And the reason, there's two main reasons that I really like working with Darren more than anything else. The first reason is that he's humble. He's not going to hop on a Zoom call or in person and show you the Ferrari or show you the private plane parked out back or show you the big house and the stuff like that, like so many of other different vendors will do. He's very humble. You know, can he do that? Sure. Is he going to do that? No, not at all. Not whatsoever. So that's what I like about him. He's also not a person that's going to be pushy or put you in a spot to where you're going to have to apologize for your client. That's the other reason why I like working with him, is that you're not going to have to apologize saying, hey, I'm sorry about the way this person acted. You know, we have other people we can work with and try to pivot to somewhere else, which no one wants to do that. So he's going to put you in a good position. And the last thing I'll say, and I noticed this right away when I started working with Darren a while ago, was that, you know, I've been doing this about 25 years in the business, and I feel I'm fairly competent when it comes to speaking to customers, when it comes to presenting insurance, and when it comes to being what I would call maybe a polished life insurance sales professional. The first time I saw Darren in front of a client, the first thing that came to my mind was, this guy's better than me. This guy's better than me. And that's the first thing I saw. And again, I don't say that lightly about too many people, but I do for him. And the way that he can interact with the customer and pivot to different personalities truly is fantastic. So please help me welcome Darren Sugiyama right here out of Orange County to come in and talk to us on our premium financing conference. So Darren, come on up.
That was one heck of an introduction. We should do this every morning, get me kind of excited, you know what I mean? So the reason I don't show you the private plane is because I don't have one. Really an honor to be here with you folks today. Premium financing is something that in the very beginning of my career, I could have never fathomed doing. As Chad said, I started out as a high school teacher in Hawaii. I primarily worked with at-risk kids, gang prevention, that sort of thing. And when I finally got into the insurance business, the reason I got into it was I moved back to California from Hawaii, and I heard a crazy rumor about a little league baseball coach of mine that was making $1 million a year selling life insurance. And so I had to find out if it was true. So I tracked him down, got in my car, went out to see him at his fancy schmancy office in Newport Beach. And I was driving back to my little cruddy one-bedroom apartment in Huntington Beach. I said to myself, man, if this idiot can do it, maybe I can do it. So that's how I got in the insurance business. I started out in employee benefits, like group health insurance for companies. And I started an agency right off the bat from scratch. I had no mentor. One of the great, really great things about your organization is you have mentors with proven track records that you can learn from, right? When I got in the business, I was literally like, I have no idea what to do. But because I was motivated, there's a fine line between being motivated and being a motivated idiot. I was probably the latter. I was very excited. I did not lack enthusiasm. And I decided I'm going to start an agency right from the get-go. So I started recruiting unlicensed agents. I met with them in the lobby of the Four Seasons Hotel in Newport Beach. It's now called the Island Hotel by Fashion Island. And the first week I did training, sales training. The second week I said, okay, go home, make your contact list, and I'll meet you back here the next Monday. You know what I did that week? I went and got my insurance license. So I started like with no direction at all. First year in the business, my tax return for 2003 is hanging on the wall of my office. My total personal income for 2003 for the entire year was $277. So if you made more than $277 in your first year in this business, you're ahead of me. So congratulations. So I'll try to make a very long story as short as possible. As things progressed, I learned some things that worked by figuring out everything that didn't work. And now I've been in this business about 20 years, it'll be my 20th year anniversary on January 3rd, 2023. It's kind of crazy. The concept of premium finance life insurance, as Chad was saying, is it's not for someone that can't afford to pay the premiums. It's for someone that can afford to pay the premiums, but would rather have that cash working in some other alternative asset, whether it's investing more in real estate or applying more money back into their portfolio or expanding their business, if they're a business owner, things like that. The concept sounds very foreign to most people, but it's really not much different than financing your education, right? A lot of folks take out student loans, but a lot of people have financed their education. They finance the purchase of their home or real estate assets through a mortgage loan, which is another form of leverage. If they own a business, pretty good chance they finance the expansion of their business through, you know, small business lines of credit, things like that. So the purchase of a life insurance policy using leverage is not all that different than things that your client has probably already done. So the way to introduce premium financing to a prospective client is to help them understand that this may feel foreign, it may feel uncomfortable, but it's really not all that different than what they've already done. It's just in a different area of their life. So in 2018, I actually filed this copyright here, or trademark rather, it's called leveraged index arbitrage. And the reason I did that was we were talking to clients, and because premium financing was a relatively new concept for a lot of these clients, what do you think they did after the first meeting? What does everyone do when they hear about a new concept they never heard of before when they go home? They Google it. And what are you gonna find when you Google premium finance? You're gonna find all kinds of garbage. Some of it's true, some of it's not so true. Some of it is completely untrue, but I wanted to control the narrative. In other words, when the person went home, I wanted to control what they were going to Google. So what is leverage index arbitrage? Leverage, right? You're using the bank capital to leverage the purchase of life insurance, that's the financing piece. Index, if we're using an IUL, it's an index account inside the life insurance policy, that's the cash value that's growing. And then arbitrage. Arbitrage is the spread that you get between the policy growth and the cost of capital, meaning the interest that the client is going to pay. So I basically made this word up. And I like it because when I was working with my attorney to file this, I did extensive searches and I wanted to come up with a descriptive term that accurately described what premium financing actually is that did not exist out there in Google. And this is what we came up with. So oftentimes you can even write this down. Leverageindexarbitrage.com is an unbranded site that we put up. Doesn't have my brand, doesn't have my contact information on it. And it's a series of 3-minute videos that takes a person through step-by-step what the advantages of premium finance life insurance are if they're using this for retirement planning. If they are looking at this for death benefit purposes, I have another microsite called hawaiipremiumfinancing.com, and I've got a very short 2-minute video that explains the general concept. So you can feel free to use those resources as you wish. Schematically, when we look at how premium financing works, essentially you have a lender, right? The lender is going to pay the premium into the policy. The client is going to make interest payments to the lender, to the bank, right? Interest-only payments. And at some point, the appreciated value, cash value of the life insurance policy can be used to pay off the bank loan, right? Once that bank loan is paid off, they could start to take tax-free income drawdowns from the policy, and or they could just leave the money in there and pass on the maximum death benefit to their beneficiary, right? So two different ways to use premium financing, right? Think of it like this. You've got super wealthy folks, super wealthy folks that are worth 20, 50, 100 million, 100 million, $1 billion. And do you know what happens when the couple, the last surviving spouse, dies from a tax standpoint? When the kids inherit all their wealth, $1 million estate, do you know what the kids have to pay in taxes? A lot. But you have to pay 40% in taxes. So here's the thing to challenge, okay? You have, let's just say, $100 million estate. Typically, $100 million estate doesn't mean they have $100 million in cash and she lost another bed, okay? They might have $50 million in real estate. The company might be there $30 million, things like that. So when the second spouse dies and the kids inherit their $100 million estate, they've got 9 months to pay the 40% estate tax bill. They have to cut a check for $40 million. Ouch. They don't have $40 million. They just have $40 million of wealth on hand. So what did they have to do to pay the taxes? They got to sell it really, really good. So wealthy folks will use premium finance life insurance for generation two to pay the estate taxes when they die. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Much, much simpler than the way to do it. The second type of reason why I use premium finance is for making someone like me. Young, handsome, good. I'm just kidding. No, so the second category of the top person that would use premium financing, someone that has a high income and is young enough to where if they died unexpectedly, car accident, something awful, cancer, you know, something like that, something very unexpected, where they died earlier than expected, the income that they would have made to pay the mortgage and to provide for their family, et cetera, that could be replaced with death benefit in the short term. But if they end up living to into their retirement years, if they don't need as much death benefit at that point, maybe the house is paid off, maybe their expenses are lower, they can use the cash value of the policy for a tax-free retirement income, right? So I kind of fit profile number two. One day, hopefully, I'll fit profile number one, but at the moment, that's not me. But you're gonna have clients and friends of friends of friends of family of friends who are gonna fall into one of those two categories all day long. You may not think you will, but you'll be amazed. For those of you that have been in the business, call it 3, 5, 10 years, you know that you know someone who knows someone who knows someone that's extremely wealthy. And you would be shocked at how little these folks know about the tax ramifications if they do nothing. So today we're gonna talk, I'm gonna show you a couple models of what happens when you do this properly using premium finance life insurance, as well as not using any life insurance at all. So what do you think interest rates are doing right now? Does anyone have a pulse on that? Are they going up? Are they going down? They're going up, right? Substantially. So I have heard a lot of folks in the life insurance business saying, oh, premium financing is going to be dead for the next 2 years because the interest rates are too high. Okay. People that say that do not understand premium financing. And I'm going to get to this at the end of our session today. In a rising interest rate environment, historically speaking, premium financing works even better. Now, I know that goes contrary to what everyone else out there is talking about, but I'm going to show you historical returns compared to historical borrowing rates. And you're going to see that symbiotic relationship between the two. You're going to find that there is a greater spread between the two during a rising interest rate environment versus stagflation or a low interest rate environment, which, again, goes contrary to what everyone thinks out there. Here are four of about a dozen different lenders that we work with here, just so you can get an idea of what rates look like today. Most lenders will use a base rate and then they'll put a spread on top of that. The spread is what the retail bank makes or the lender makes. So some will use the CMT rate, the constant maturity treasury rate. Some will use the SOFR rate, the standard overnight federal rate. Some will use prime. Number of different ways to configure these loans. But where it says total rate, this kind of gives you an idea of a range of different lending rates out there right now, with a lot of other lenders in between there. The rates will vary depending on the size of the loan. They'll also vary based on the type of collateral the client is going to post, whether they're gonna move the collateral to the bank or they're just gonna leave it where it's at and post it as collateral. And so all of those different variables will dictate the loan terms and the rates. I know a lot of folks will say, Darren, can you put together this proposal for me? I have a client who needs $10 million in death benefit. Well, I could do it that way and just use one rate, but that's not doing the client the best service. I want to find the best rate with the best lending terms based on that client's unique situation. And so everything we do is extremely customized. And quite frankly, it takes me and my staff a lot more time to do, but it is definitely in the best interest of your client. This concept, forward curve rates, you may hear this out there. The forward curve rates are something that are usually published quarterly. And it's the, in layman's terms, the smart money guys around the world say, here's what we think is going to happen in the future with interest rates. What they're saying right now is that they expect interest rates to spike next year. Again, we're seeing some of them climb. We're seeing some actually starting to decrease a little bit over the last week or two here. But they're expecting it to spike next year and then slowly decline over the next 6-7 years and then kind of level off here. Again, this is crystal ball stuff, right? I'm not a crystal ball guy, but this is what the so-called smart money guys are saying. When I model premium financing, I always model an increasing interest rate because I would much rather under-promise and then over-deliver, right? And then if we work together, you're going to find that I won't budge on that. My integrity is way too important. And quite frankly, I want to make sure that this client stays a client and hopefully a friend for a very, very, very long time. I am not in the transactional business. I was on a Zoom call this morning and I told the advisor, I won't finance that case. He said, why not? I said, because it's not right for the client. He goes, yeah, but the commission is X. I go, you go do it with someone else. I don't want to do it because it's not right for the client. Not every so-called rich person is right for premium financing. Some are not. And I'll be the first one to tell you when it's not a good fit. In our proposals, we're always going to show the logical alternative. What are the two logical alternatives to not buying premium finance life insurance? Alternative number one, they could buy a non-finance policy. How much is that going to cost? Alternative number two, they could do nothing. What's that going to cost? And so we'll show them an apples-to-apples-to-apples comparison. If premium financing does not give them the best return on their money, then I'll tell them don't do it. And everyone's like, oh, my God, Darren, don't tell my client not to buy the gigantic $10 million life insurance. I'll tell them don't do it. I rarely lose because financing works in most cases. Sometimes it doesn't, and I'll tell you when it doesn't work. So this is one page in our proposal here. We'll show them the non-finance policy, level $10 million death benefit, is going to cost $280,000 a year in annual premium on a 10 pay. Okay. If they finance the premiums, it hits a low point death benefit of just over $10 million. They're going to recover 100% of their costs. So in this scenario, their net cost is zero. If you're the client, which one do you do? Do you buy the policy that's going to quote unquote cost you $2.8 million out of pocket that you'll never see again for a level $10 million? Or do you start off with over $20 million in net death benefit, recover all your costs and have it cost zero? Which one do you do? Come on, what are we arguing about? In the blue column there, that is a non-insurance-based investment account growing at the same 5.74% return in the policy, minus taxes, minus investment fees, minus the 40% in estate taxes. So if we look at that, on the right-hand side of the screen there, I think that tells a pretty interesting story there. You want the green, the orange, or the blue? The green has a net zero cost. The orange, you flush $2.8 million out of your bank account. And the blue is you do nothing. See, the blue did not save them money. The blue cost them money. Doing nothing costs the client money. So when someone says, well, I don't want to pay for life insurance, well, it's not a matter of paying for the life insurance. It's a matter of, do you want less money or more money to go to your heirs? Right? Don't be, I was going to say stupid, but don't be stubborn. How's that? That's a better S word. Okay. So in this particular scenario here, premium finance version, initial face amount, $27.9 million. Interest paid out of pocket, $7.2 million. Cost recovered, $7.2 million. Net cost is zero. Low point death benefit, just over $10 million. And the death benefit at age 90. By the way, I only sell policies that last until age 120, as illustrated. All this stuff about, oh, the client's not going to live past age 103. It's okay. It's not okay with me, because if something bad happens and the S&P doesn't perform, the index doesn't perform as expected, and the policy lapses at age 103, assuming in this case 5.74%, if it does less than that, it's going to lapse earlier. Okay, non-finance policy, what do we got here, right? Initial face amount, $10 million. Premium paid out of pocket, $2.8 million. Zero drawdown, so your net cost is $2.8 million. Low point death benefit, $10 million, because it's $10 million, essentially all the way to the end of the rainbow there. That's a pretty compelling comparison, right? Everything we do is mathematically based, right? It's all quantitative. There's no feelings in math. I don't feel like this. I don't care about your stupid little baby feelings, okay? It's, you are going to make a mathematical decision for your benefit, or you're going to make an emotional decision that is not good for you or your family. It's just not. We want to have an honest, transparent, blunt conversation with the client. There's no tippy-toeing around. If I show them the math and they still elect to do something else, that's their decision, right? It's a free country. They can do whatever they want. I'm going to make a compelling comparison, but at the end of the day, if they say, I don't want to do it, not, I don't push. I don't chase anybody, okay? If they're not, and I'm saying this kind of tongue-in-cheek, but I'm also kind of serious about it. If they're not begging for this, this is probably not the right solution for them. So here's dollars in, dollars out. Green is the premium finance solution. That $25.4 million is the beginning of year one death benefit, the face amount. Orange is the non-finance policy, $2.8 million cost, $10 million in level death benefit. And then the blue, we are taking the income out of the blue as well, just to match up with the premium financing solution there. And the year 40 account value is just over $5.3 million. So again, apples to apples to apples, right? Have you ever had a conversation with a client where you were trying to make the argument that the after-tax value of the policy would be greater than investing it in the market? Have you ever had a client argue with you? Have you ever won that argument? You usually don't win that argument because you can't back up the math. This is why our platform is so powerful, because I'm giving you the tools to show them the math. In fact, I do better than that. I am the one that tells them and shows them the math. Very, very involved in the point of sale. So a handful of things that make us extremely different. The first thing is we have these cool backtesting reports, which I'm going to explain in a second. No one in the industry has this. We also do a very in-depth product analysis, as well as we produce these custom videos for your client. You ever have a meeting with a client and you thought it went really well, and then they went home and they talked to their spouse and their spouse ruined everything? And then so you beg for the meeting with their spouse, and then you get the husband and wife or the spouse and spouse, whatever it is. You have the couple meeting, and then they say, okay, let me think about it. And who do they go talk to? They talk to one of their idiot brother-in-laws, or they talk to their CPA who thinks they knows everything, or they talk to their friend that's an attorney, or whatever. What you have now done is outsourced the sales process to a terrible salesperson. They will never be able to articulate it the way you will. And they sure as heck ain't gonna be able to articulate it the way I will. So when we produce this custom video, we upload it to the cloud, we give you the link, you can circulate that link, and now the client can share that link with all the interested parties in their camp that want to better understand how this works. So now they're hearing it directly from the source. Much, much better. They can pause it, rewind it, watch it a gazillion times. So great for an education standpoint, equally as important, it's great from a compliance standpoint, because we now have record in the client file that we talked about all the moving parts, the collateral, the variable interest rates, what could happen, good, bad, ugly, all of that, right? It's all in these custom videos. So when we talk about estate taxes, again, this is same client here, $10 million in low point death benefit need. We're going to start off showing them what happens to their $10 million investment portfolio over time. We're assuming their $10 million investment portfolio is growing at a rate of 5.74%. Again, same return, gross return in the policy. but they're going to end up paying a little over 30% in capital gains tax on the gain if they're living in California after years go by at age 90. So we can set the life expectancy age in our software. And this, we just so happen to set it at 90. At age 90, the after capital gains tax value at age 90 of this portfolio that started at $10 million is $28.5 million. If they died at age 90, they would pass that on to generation two. Generation two would pay 40% in estate taxes. And so generation two would end up with $17.1 million net. Okay. If we take the same exact investment portfolio, we would peel estate itty bitty little piece off to service the interest payments on the premium financing policy, that the remainder of that investment account is going to grow under the same assumptions, 5.74%, same capital gains tax, same estate tax, and generation two is going to inherit $12.3 million net from the investment account. But what else are they going to get? They're going to get the tax-free death benefit of $16.2 million. So generation two is going to net $28.6 million instead of $17.1 million. Now, in this scenario here, how much did the life insurance policy cost? Now, you say zero because we recovered the cost, right? But even if they didn't recover the cost, how much did the life insurance policy cost? These guys aren't paying for this out of cash flow. They're moving money from their left pocket to their right pocket. They have $10 million in liquid in their investment account. They're repositioning a small amount into another asset that sits inside the same portfolio. It doesn't cost them anything. It's a repositioning of assets, right? If I have $100 in my left pocket and I move 50 of that 100 into my right pocket, did it cost me $50? No, you still got $100. I own the pants. It's the same pair of pants. It's two different pockets. You follow? Simple, right? See, I'm not fancy, man. I'm just telling the way it is. Once they understand that, all of a sudden cost kind of goes out the window. Rarely do I have an issue with cost after I explain this to them. Okay. So again, $10 million starting point, 5.74% return. Annually, 1.35% all-in investment fee, 32.6% in capital gains tax, 40% in estate tax. That's a lot of tax, isn't it? And so this is what it looks like. Investment portfolio without life insurance in the blue. We're investment portfolio in the green, peeling a little bit off of that investment account to pay the interest on the life insurance. Recovering all the interest expense via policy drawdown. And so green column on the right is the total portfolio value in each year if they were to die in each one of those years. That's a pretty fair comparison right there, right? Blue line on the right side of the screen, portfolio value in each year without the life insurance, and then the green portfolio value investment account plus the death benefit, the net death benefit in each one of those years. Life expectancy in this case, age 90, there is a 67% increase in total value going to generation two. Great question. He's asking, when do we take the drawdowns out to replenish the out-of-pocket expense? Depends on the age, depends on the health. And quite frankly, this is a big pain in the butt for me and my staff to do because we have to literally go in there and hunt and peck. Let's try this. Nope, it's too much. Death benefit fall below 10 million, right? So let's push it out. Or, oh my God, we got 12 million low point. Let's push up the drawdowns earlier. So it varies client to client to client. Yeah. Great question though. Okay. So again, we say life insurance is not an expense. It's a repositioning of the assets. That's the big thing I want you to take away with you today when it comes to premium financing. For death benefit purposes, it's not an expense. It's a repositioning or a reallocation of assets. Here's an example. I'm Mr. Analogy Man. You'll figure this out over time here. Okay. Let's say you have a house and you have $1 million painting hanging on your wall in your living room and the sunlight is coming through the window and it's beating up the painting, right? It's starting to fade. The value is not going to grow as much over time because you got damaged goods. Okay. If you traded that painting out for a different painting, how much did it cost you to trade it? Zero. Okay. If you trade it for a different painting and then you move that painting into another room where there's no direct sunlight coming through the window, beating it up, and the value doubled up to $2 million. Again, how much did it cost you to do that transaction? It's your art collection. It's in your house. You own the whole deal. It doesn't matter what assets are what. You want to grow your art collection to the maximum value. Okay. The direct sunlight is analogous to taxes. What are we doing? We're taking a taxable asset and moving it into a non-taxable environment in the form of a life insurance policy. So again, how much does it cost you to do that? Zippo, right? It's to rebalance. Does it, when someone trades out a stock, does anyone say, oh, how much did that cost? Right? You're switching out an asset for another asset, okay? AG49A, it's the regulator, the insurance industry regulators passed this deal that basically limited what a life insurance carrier can show in terms of the index return in a policy. Okay, used to be able to show something a lot higher. So 5.74%, that's in Pacific Life Horizon product as of today. That could change in the future. But as of right now, that's the maximum illustrated rate. What is that? That is the average of every 25-year window over the last 65 years. That's how the insurance regulators determine that. And it's different from carrier to carrier, product to product. So this particular one, 5.74%. Raise your hand if you think that is understated, meaning you think in reality it's going to do better. Raise your hand if you think it's going to do better. Raise your hand if you think it's going to do worse than that. You think, oh, these Pacific Life people, they sure do know how to over-exaggerate things and make it look good on paper. How many of you have no idea if that's good or bad or realistic or unrealistic? Nobody knows, right? That's crystal ball. That's crystal ball. But wouldn't you like to know what happens in the short term and the long term if there were to be a lot of volatility? Like, how many zeros can an IUL withstand over time? Does it change the outcome if the zeros come in clusters earlier on in the policy versus later in the policy? If you finance the premiums and you have the cost of financing the interest, if the interest rates are going up and you hit a couple zeros, about 10 years ago, I started asking these questions myself. The reason I started asking myself these questions is I wanted to know, does this crap actually work? Like the floor and the cap, how does that work? How was that constructed? I drove underwriters and actuaries crazy with my questions until I finally built my model of backtesting. Then I went around all the advanced markets attorneys and all the compliance departments with the carriers and say, this is what I built. I want to know if you guys are okay with this. But I built a model where we could backtest, where we could see what would actually have happened. So in our model, we literally backtest 121 different 40-year historical periods of S&P 500 performance. Sounds like overkill, right? Here's why we did it. Because life insurance illustrations, it's kind of an illusion in some cases. Like if you take these two coffee tables right here, okay? If you look at that edge right there, let's say it was 4 feet long. Do you think that that edge is longer or shorter than the front edge of the square coffee table? No. It looks longer, doesn't it? It looks longer, but looks can be deceiving. So if we take that same measuring stick, rotate it on its side, slide it down, it is literally the exact same length. It's an optical illusion. And a lot of these life insurance policy illustrations, let me tell you something, they're optical illusions. There are good products, IUL products, and there are not so good IUL products. The problem is that when you run them all at a constant, flat, positive interest rate every year, they all look good. When you dump the data into our software and we backtest it, some of these things do not look so good. So the importance of the volatility backtesting is because if the charges are structured in a way where the charges are eating up the cash value, where you're getting 0% returns, all of a sudden that cash value can dwindle into nothing and the policy will lapse, right? So this is what we look at here. This is how I explain this. This is a great, by the way, steal this slide and use this with your clients. I went over trust inside of 60 seconds with this little talk here. So say, look, if I was your investment advisor and I got you a 50% return in year one, and I lost you 50% in year two, what is the average return I got you? What is it? Zero, right? But if you gave me $100 to invest, then I got you a 50% return in year one. What's your account balance at the end of year one? 150. If I lost you 50% of your account balance, of your $150 account balance in year two, at the end of year two, what do you got? You have $75. So I've effectively actually lost you 25% of your money, which is an internal rate of return of negative 13.4% compounded annually over those 2 years. So when people talk about average returns, I know right off the bat, they do not understand finance. They do not understand return on investment. So that's why I built what I built. Okay. So again, 121 different 40-year historical periods we model. And the idea here from a compliance standpoint is we call it a proxy. I built a proxy for the IUL product. What does that mean? We call it a leveraged hypothetical synthetic asset, which is a fancy way of saying it's a fake investment account that doesn't exist in reality, but behaves very similar to an IUL. Charges, credits, et cetera, et cetera. So here's how it works. We started out January 1st, 1970. We roll the clock forward 40 years. That's an end point of December 31st, 2009. During that period of time, those are all the S&P returns in those years without S&P 500 dividends. And the compound annual growth rate, which is if you just dropped a dollar in year one and let it do its thing over the 40-year period, what would the annual return be based on all that volatility? Compound annual growth rate, 6.43%. But then we said, what would happen if someone started 1 month later in the same year? Everyone does this year to year to year. Hey, if remember when COVID hit in March of 2020, oil was trading at like negative 40 bucks a barrel or something like that. If your segment ended at the end of February versus the end of March, right? If you had started 1 month earlier or later, you either did okay or you got punched in the face financially, right? Right, big difference. So we said, okay, let's start 1 month later. It's February 1st, 1970. Roll the clock forward 40 years. Endpoint January 31st, 2010. During that period of time, compound annual growth rate was 6.5%. And then what would happen if we just did that all the way forward to the end of 2019? It was 121 different periods. We tagged the best compound annual growth rate, 40 years, and the 40-year period that produced the worst compound annual growth rate. And here is what the worst one looks like. I always show them the worst first. Because if the worst works, we're going to run out of reasons to not do this thing. No one cares about the best. Right? Your greed might care about the best. Client's greed might care about the best. But my fiduciary responsibility side of me says, let's start with the worst and let's focus on the worst. So here's the worst period. In the worst 40-year period in the first 10 years, there were 4 years of negative S&P returns. Talk about a cruddy way to start things off, right? Sequence of returns, bad. We then apply the floor and cap, and we even have the ability to include any multiplier bonuses with the associated asset-based charges. The question is, does that thing work during periods of time where the performance is not so good? Don't you want to know that? No one can show you that except for me. Okay. So there we go. 4-0% index credits in the first 10-year period. That seems kind of rough. So we'll show them the charges page. Okay. This is in all of our proposals as well. We show them the charges page for the best 40-year period, the worst 40-year period, and the most recent 40-year period. This is the worst 40-year period again. These standard charges were pulling right out of the carrier illustration. And then these charges here, these are the asset-based charges to get the multiplier, right? So in a Pack Life product, it's going to be either performance or performance plus, whatever it is. Our system imports all of this data based on what the client is considering buying. And then we're going to run these proxy back tests to show them, does the design hold up over time when it's stressed? So we'll talk about how the product credits as well, right? So in this year right here, S&P did 37.91% at an 8.5% cap multiplied by the multiplier bonus. That would have returned a 17.94% return in that given year, right? That's what you would get as the what we call the effective index credit. In a year, however, where you got a negative 15.51% return, you would have gotten a zero. The problem is zero times the multiplier is still zero. So when you get a zero and you have no multiplier benefit, do you still have to pay the multiplier charge? Absolutely, right? So in that year, the total charges, negative $1.4 million in that year. So your cash value would decrease $1.4 million in that year if this scenario actually existed. That's where people freak out. The question is the bounce back worth it, right? When the market recovers and you get the multiplier, does it work? So that is what we look to see. Plus, whenever I hear someone say, oh, the best thing about an IUL is a 0% floor, that means you could never lose money. Yeah, that's not true. Yeah, you are going to lose money. You're going to lose the charges in that year that you get a zero index return. So all of this is documented in our proposals, as well as in this custom client video that we produce for your clients that goes in your client file. So if they ever say, oh, they told me that I could never lose money, look at page, 47 of 76, and we go through that. Okay? This is another one of my favorite slides in our proposal. This graph here, the blue line, shows the as-illustrated cash value over the first 40 years of the policy, as illustrated, assuming that 5.74% constant return every year. Okay? The dotted green line shows the simulated account value in our proxy during the worst 4-year period. The dashed green line shows the account value in the best 40-year period. But here's the thing that gets me excited. And this is why I laugh in the face of all the folks that say, premium financing is going to be dead for 2 years because the interest rates are so high. The solid green line is the most recent 40-year period. That's 1982 through 2021. In 1982, prime was 11%. Today, prime is 7%. So one of our lenders uses a prime-based loan. They go prime minus 1.6. Okay, so 11% minus 1.6. The borrowing rate in 1982 with that particular lender set up would have been 9.4%. Can you imagine trying to sell premium financing today if the borrowing rate was 9.4%? When last year it was sub 2% if the policy was big enough, right? That seems like a stretch. Well, what I did is I matched up the borrowing rate in 1982 to the S&P performance in 1982 with the floor and the cap, with the multiplier, minus all the charges. And over time, what we see here is the internal rate of return over this 40-year period was 6% tax-free. That's the simulated cash value, not even the death benefit. During the most recent 40-year period with borrowing rates north of 9% for the first 3 years of borrowing. If that doesn't make you feel better, I don't know what will. The discussion about premium financing is the spread. It's not the borrowing rate in isolation. Left side of the screen, best 40-year period. Right side of the screen, worst 40-year period. The blue line represents the non-insurance-based investment account, minus taxes, minus investment fees, minus estate taxes. The green line represents the greater of the as-illustrated death benefit or the simulated account value in our proxy. So all along the way there, that client, for the most part, except for a few years there, in the worst 40-year period, is way ahead from a generation wealth transfer standpoint. If we look at life expectancy, age 90 there, there's a difference in the best 40-year period and the worst 40-year period. Again, very difficult to argue the math. I love getting on meetings with CPAs who are extremely technical and even adversarial. I love those discussions because those folks are smart enough to ask all the questions that should be asked. And then I've got quantifiable, quantitative answers to answer those questions that they're smart enough to ask. So the more adversarial they are, we end up becoming like blood brothers at the end of that meeting. And then that's where the referrals start. Okay. As we wrap up here, we'll leave a little bit of time for Q&A, but a black swan event. Have you heard that term before, a black swan event? A black swan event is an event that is unplanned for, that comes as a surprise and is typically devastating. Lots of black swan events could happen. And so without the stress testing, without showing increasing interest rates, without showing four zeros in the first 10 years of the sequence without showing the client all those things. Black swan event happens. You don't know if this thing's going to hold up, which to me is crazy. Client's going to buy tens of million dollars of insurance, and you got no way of knowing if it's going to hold up if one or two black swan events happen. Crazy. If those things happen, you have to deal with the aftermath. All right. It's not cool, man. It is not. It's bad, bad news. Okay. So here's the thing. Here's what you're going to find out there. Here's what you're competing against. Okay. I won't name carriers. I won't name other marketing organizations, but there are some out there that are out there selling these over leveraged free insurance. Have you ever come across this? Oh, the client doesn't want to pay anything out of pocket. Yeah, well, guess what? Neither do I. Okay. If you could go back to 2006 and buy real estate and not make your full mortgage payment and just accrue all the debt, would you do that? No, you'd be upside down, right? It's going to ruin your credit, ruin your whole life. But that's what these folks are doing. They're saying, don't pay the interest out of pocket, just accrue it. Accrue it means don't pay it, roll it back into the loan balance. And now you're adding more debt and you're accruing more debt. So now as your policy value, hopefully, is growing compounded growth over time, now your debt is growing compounded growth over time. Right? That is extremely risky. So poorly designed premium financing arrangements, big, big root of the problem. Poorly articulated to the client, meaning the client, you didn't do a good job of explaining to the client how all this stuff works, or whoever you're working with that's in, you know, my position is supposed to be explaining the details to the clients, doesn't do a good job or a thorough job. They're just trying to get the sale. It happens all the time. Poorly documented. You have nothing in the client file to prove that you actually discussed and disclosed all these things to the client. Huge thing, right? That's what the value of the video. And then the last thing here is poor suitability. If you sell the wrong client a premium financing arrangement, but if it wasn't the right fit for the client, what are we doing? I spoke at an event in Dallas a few weeks ago with a bunch of CPAs and attorneys and life insurance agents and investment advisors. And I had this discussion. I said, are we just in this to make a big commission? And like half of the room started laughing. I got so pissed. I said, are you serious right now? Is that what we're doing? Is that the business we're in? That's not the business I'm in. And all the room kind of quieted down. That pissed me off though. You wouldn't be laughing if it was your mom. You wouldn't be laughing if it was your child. So this whole idea of leverage, right? There's responsible leverage and then there's irresponsible leverage. Not all leverage is good. Not all leverage is bad. It just has to be appropriate for the client. Okay. So this whole thing about the myth of free insurance, this deal got proposed to me. Okay. Agent brought this in. There's the annual premiums. They said borrow 100% of the premium. Don't pay anything out of pocket. Accrue all the debt. And then start taking drawdowns from the policy to gradually pay off the debt. Now, the reason it worked in the carrier illustration is the carrier illustration was run at, I think, 6.2% or something, north of 6%. And then the borrowing rates they showed on the left-hand side of the screen do not exist today. No one's getting money that cheap, believe me, not in premium financing. So they show gradually pay down the loan by taking the drawdowns. We continue to do that all the way until the 29th year of the policy. And then we're going to yank out $18.8 million to pay the loan off. And don't worry, it'll make it to age 105 and then it'll lapse. Now, remember what I said about age 120? Why do I say age 120? What happens at age 120 if the person's still alive? Policy endows and they get the death benefit while they're still alive, right? If they make it to age 120, not that that's going to happen very often, but as a safeguard. So I looked at this and I said, look, it kind of sort of works. Kind of, sort of, assuming a 6.05% index spread, 6.05. So I couldn't stand it. I had to run this in our back testing. Okay. In the best 40-year period, they said don't pay off the loan. Let the death benefit pay off the loan. Because if they pay off the loan when they're supposed to pay off the loan, the policy would lapse. They said, don't pay off the loan. Okay, so let's let the debt accrue. At the end of 40 years, it would have accrued to $79 million of debt. The accumulated value in year 40, during the best 40-year period in the proxy, was $77.3 million. So they would be upside down $1.6 million after 40 years. That's the best 40-year period. You want to see the worst 40-year period? Same $79 million of debt, accumulated value $57 million. They're upside down $21.6 million. This is the same policy that worked using the carrier illustrated numbers and the premium financiers' borrowing rates that I know they can't get. Now, when you look at the carrier illustrated, that looks like a good deal. Didn't cost them anything. It's free. Look, if it's truly free, sign me up. I'll buy five of them. I'll buy 20 of them if it's truly free. Right? Come on. Then I'm all lit using the forward curve rates. Remember I said the forward curve rates, all the smart money guys think the borrowing rates are going to go down? So now I'm all up with the borrowing rates going down, and still, yeah, you're still upside down $3.8 million. This is bad news, guys. But this is what some of your competitors are out there selling. But they don't see what I just showed you. All they see is the carrier illustration that works. Put them in front of me. I will crush their dreams of delusion. All right? This is not for someone that can't afford to make the payments. All right? This is how you feel when you close a big premium financing case and then you get smacked with a black swan event. I love this quick little video clip here. There are multi-million dollar lawsuits going on right now as we speak, where clients are suing advisors and carriers on, for premium financing cases that were designed wrong. The downside of it is that, I mean, I know agents that will show a carrier one thing, submit the case using the carrier guidelines, and then behind the scenes, they do something completely different. It's a bait and switch. The carrier cannot police that. Who knows what the client was told by the agent? That's the liability that all of you folks incur when you work with the wrong premium financing advisor. I know that sounds self-serving, but you're either going to be do this with full disclosure, or you're going to go for the easy sale. Easy sale equals easy lawsuit. Proper suitable sale equals blood brother soul sister for life. Right? If this is done right. So again, I'll wrap with this. I've had folks say, well, what you're doing is you're doing a Monte Carlo simulation. A Monte Carlo simulation is a fancy way that investment advisors measure probability of risk. You have a probability that this is going to happen. 90% probability this is going to happen. 80% probability this is going to happen. The problem with measuring probability of risk solely is it doesn't really tell you the real world scenario, right? I measure consequence of risk, not necessarily just probability of risk. Here's probability of risk. Would you feel comfortable with a 90% probability that something's going to happen? Most people would. Most people would. But let's say I got 10 handguns on the table, and 9 of them are unloaded. 1 of them has a bullet in the chamber. So you have a 90% probability that everything's going to be okay. Would you feel comfortable picking up one of the 10 guns, holding it to your child's head, and squeezing the trigger? You don't know if it's that one or that one or that one. You don't know. I am not willing to sacrifice this based on a 90% probability. You should not be comfortable with a 90% probability that everything's going to be okay with your client if the consequence of risk is everything falls apart, right? Like if I had a 90% probability I'm gonna eat tacos tonight, I feel good about that because I like tacos. If the 10% chance that I'm not gonna eat tacos is I gotta eat cheeseburgers, that's okay. I don't like cheeseburgers as much as I like tacos, but cheeseburgers are cool. But if I don't get tacos and I got like death, Now the 90% probability doesn't make me feel good. So that's why I built what I built. I'll share something very, very personal with you. The employee benefits business I built, I brought these young kids into the business, taught them everything from the ground up, made some young folks very, very financially successful. And several years ago, two-thirds of them got together and formed a coup against me and set up a competitive agency across the parking lot, from another high-rise building. And behind my back, stole two-thirds of my firm's clients. And I was losing $40,000 a month. I was going broke. And I went to a very dark place. I was bitter. I was embarrassed. I couldn't pay my bills. I couldn't pay my mortgage, which was not small, trust me. It was a bad situation. Burned through all my savings. And I didn't know if I was going to survive. That experience was the best thing that ever happened to me. There is no greater blessing than understanding what true humility is, where you judge less and you appreciate more, even if you have less. Went through this whole rebuilding process, rebuilt my company, rebuilt the business model, focused more on premium financing than the old business model. And believe me, the getting into the premium financing space, or it was 7-8 years ago, that's not something you just jump into. And it took a while. It took a while to rebuild. And in that process, I got reacquainted with my Japanese roots. And I started studying the ways of the samurai. Samurai lived by 7 core life principles. And I took those principles and applied them. And what I found was when you rebuild the person's spirit, the business follows. When the business is rebuilt because the person's spirit is rebuilt, the money follows. Last year is the best year I've had in business in 20 years. And so if you're going through struggle right now, if you're rebuilding, maybe some of you are rebuilding your personal life, divorce, tough relationship with your kids, you know, brokenheartedness, it's not easy, but I will tell you that the principles I wrote about in this book changed my whole life, and hopefully they will help you and change yours too.
I love it. Awesome. Well, again, in Zoom land, thank you for tuning in. We certainly appreciate it. For all the local people, thank you for showing up as well too. I hope you enjoyed this. And what makes you reduce employees in the future? So thank you very much. All right.